Good evening. I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the great privilege of being the president of Hunter College and the pleasure to welcome all of you tonight to this evening's discussion with David Stockman. His book, The Great Deformation, The Corruption of Capitalism in America, became a New York Times bestseller almost from the moment it was published. Now, that's a lot to say about a 700-page book that talks about such heady matters as the gold standard, Keynesian economics, monetary policy, and ultimately the future of our democracy. The book also says a few things about FDR and the New Deal, and not exactly in the most laudatory of terms. As I'm sure we'll hear this evening, David is unstinting in his criticism of FDR and his policies, many of which, David, you've just found out, were undoubtedly planned right here in this house. So this was the house that served as FDR's presidential transition headquarters, and many of the ideas, as I said, that would become the New Deal were really hatched right here. We like to think that FDR, who never shied away from a good political argument, would welcome a lively debate about his economic policies taking place right here in his former home, where he and Eleanor lived from 1908 until they moved to the White House in 1933. The house was a wedding gift from Franklin's mother, Sarah. It came with one caveat, however. Sarah kept this half of it for herself. Now, as some of you know, we like to call this the first New Deal. And David, we'd love to hear your reactions to that transaction. Since this house is where FDR first introduced his economic policies to the nation, and where Francis Perkins, FDR's future Secretary of Labor, suggested that the program, suggested to Franklin the program that ultimately became Social Security, there really could, David, be no more appropriate setting for your discussion tonight. David Stockman is a person whose name is well known to anyone who cares about policy and politics in American life. First elected to Congress in 1976, David Stockman rose to national and international prominence in 1981 when he served as President Reagan's first budget director and as one of the architects of what is now hailed as the Reagan Revolution. Although for many years he was at the center of power, he has always remained an independent thinker whose grasp of how power is used and abused in Washington is clear-eyed and whose courage in telling us is unfailing. He is sometimes referred to as the little boy who cried, "The emperor has no clothes." The Washington Post described David as a serial apostate, no doubt a tongue-in-cheek reference to his having once been a divinity student. But it went on to say that the Great Deformation is a persuasive and deeply relevant indictment of a system dangerously akilt. The Wall Street Journal called it a welcome thrashing of the ruling classes in both parties. Well, we hope the thrashing will be kept to a minimum during your Q&A period, David. But I know you will welcome the challenge. We're very happy that you're here. We look forward to a lively conversation, and we'll let everyone know that you'll be upstairs after the discussion signing books. David Stockman, it's a pleasure to have you.
Well, first, let me thank you for saying something nice about my book right here in FDR's backyard, because actually it's the first time anybody has said anything nice. My book has been out a month. It's been denounced from all points on the political compass, you know, the right and the left and the Republicans and the Democrats and the Keynesians and the monetarists and the supply-siders and Wall Street and K Street and the military-industrial complex and also the neocons and the social cons and the just cons. And for you for those of you who haven't heard of the just cons, that's everybody else in Washington that doesn't fit the other categories. Now, I can understand why it's been so roundly criticized, because I basically don't think very much of crony capitalism. That's what I think we have in this country today, and it's undermining our democracy, as I say in the book, and it's undermining a prosperous free market economy as well. So I think it was fair enough that all these brickbats came flying out from different points on the compass at my book, but I really thought that Professor Paul Krugman went a little too far. Now, I realize he is the self-anointed and appointed, tribune of all matters correct on economics. But unfortunately, or fortunately as the case may be, he denounced my book within one day of its release as the ravings of a cranky old man. And, you know, that even aroused my 85-year-old mother, who, after reading the Cranky Old Man blog, immediately shot back an email to me saying, "Doesn't he know? Actually, you were a cranky young man, too." Apparently, you never got over it. Well, in any event, there must be a lot of people in the country who sympathize with cranky writers, old or young, because the funniest thing that happened was within a couple of days, the book went shot right up to the top of the list. I was amazed. It was only stopped from hitting the top spot on Amazon by two diet books and something called The Walking Dead, which is some kind of horror novel. But at least I felt like maybe I'm in the right zip code. And I don't say this in any kind of boastful way, but the truth is, the very first week, it was number 4 on the New York Times bestseller list. And the reason I'm not boasting is that they're still debating internally whether that's going to be on the fiction or the nonfiction category. And I think there's quite a few people who think that maybe it should be in the fiction category. Anyway, there is a lot in the book, mostly about what has happened since 1950. There is a couple chapters on the New Deal. I think what I would like to do tonight is spend our Q&A time on that, because I want to start from the other end of the 80-year history that the book actually addresses, where we ended up. Because I believe that there is a lot of mythology about what happened in the 1930s, what caused the Great Depression, whether the Fed had anything to do with it or not, whether the Roosevelt policies actually got us out of the Great Depression. And you can have long, unending, almost academic debates about that, but I think it's rather interesting that here we are in 2013, and over we still have a debate about how the Great Depression started, what caused it, how we got out of it, whether the New Deal helped or hurt. And yet, today, we're implementing, allegedly, measures, both on the monetary side massively and on the fiscal side massively, that were allegedly lessons learned from the 1930s that we're now implementing in order to avoid a reprise of that unfortunate chapter in our history. So what I'd like to do tonight is start with where we are, suggest that it's not working out as well as a lot of people might have wanted or expected, and then divine from that some conclusions about where we started way back when in the 1930s. I think my starting point is that in the fall and winter of 2008 and 2009, we had literally a shock and awe campaign of Keynesian stimulus from every point of the machinery of the government, based on a belief that we couldn't afford to risk a repeat of the 1930s. And certainly that's what Bernanke thought he was doing at the Fed. And he did it with, I think, reckless abandon. I'm not going to spend a whole time tonight on a critique of the Fed, but I think it's the heart of the policies that we're pursuing. And it's important to remind ourselves how massive that stimulus was. It was literally a monetary blitzkrieg that had no prior precedent in history. They lowered the interest rate, as you remember, to 0 in December 2008. It's still 0. They're going to keep it at 0 until 2015. It means 6 years of money that's basically free. That free money is doing almost nothing to help the Main Street economy, in my view, but it's a tremendous source of gambling chits for Wall Street and for speculators and hedge funds and the fast money that basically can borrow in the repo market or in the unsecured overnight market, buy anything that has a yield, and then capture the spread. But I want to suggest today, and I suggest in my book, that this is pretty radical stuff. It's hard to grasp it, I think, sometimes. But let me just give you one number, which I think maybe puts it in perspective. The first 94 years of the Fed's existence, from when it was opened in 1914, until the Lehman Brothers event, it took 94 years to get the balance sheet of the Fed to $900 billion. Under good chairman, bad chairman, Arthur Burns was one of the latter category, obviously Volcker was one of the former, William McChesney Martin was one of the former. But anyway, through war and peace and good times and bad times, 94 years we got $900 billion of balance sheet. And then in 7 weeks of panic, after the Lehman collapse and the meltdown on Wall Street, the balance sheet grew by $900 billion in 7 weeks. And even then they weren't done. After 13 weeks, early December, the balance sheet of the Fed was $2.3 trillion compared to $900 billion over the first 94 years. Today it is $3.4 trillion, and under the policies they have underway, it's going to be $4 trillion. And the reason I'm mentioning this is that all of that balance sheet is created money out of thin air. It's flowing in to the financial system. It never gets out of the canyons of Wall Street, in my judgment. It fuels bubble after bubble. The Fed has now become a serial bubble machine. They had great celebration in the market today, but I think it's just the fourth bubble that we've had in this decade. As a matter of fact, we're not too far above, even with all the celebration, where we were actually 4,750 days ago. Now, if you're still doing long division, divide by 13, divide by 365, carry the 10, and that amounts to 13 years. We're basically today in the market where we were in March 2000. So one, we've had this enormous flood of money, and I think basically it has reignited a financial bubble at the top of our economic system, but it hasn't done a lot to regenerate a solid economy. I'll talk about that in a minute. Now, the second thing we had was a fiscal tidal wave that we've never seen before, and I'll just take 365 days from February 2008, when the panic first began and we had the original Bush tax cut, as you remember that, I don't mean the big ones from the early part of the decade, but I mean the rebate. That was only $200 billion. It was to try to help things along. Then we had TARP at $700 billion in September, early October, and then we had the Obama stimulus the following February, $800. And what it meant was that $1.7 trillion got injected into the economy in 365 days, going through a congressional process that was a far cry from any kind of deliberation or serious analysis. The money was just shoved at the economy. The money was just poured into the economy. All of these things based on the predicate that somehow we were on the cusp of the Great Depression 2.0, a massive financial meltdown that was going to take the whole economy and all of America with it. Now, the argument in my book is that none of this really was valid. We weren't on the lip of Great Depression 2.0, and I will say a few things about that. And therefore, the Wall Street bailout was not needed, and it was essentially a bailout of the last two or three gambling houses standing, basically Goldman and Morgan Stanley. And we should have basically let them go down, let the marketplace be cleansed, and we would have a far more disciplined, a far more stable system today. In the book, I have a whole section called the BlackBerry Panic of 2008. And the reason I call it the BlackBerry Panic is that basically policy was being made in the palm of people's hands. In other words, they were running around the third floor of the Treasury building, looking at their BlackBerries, watching the price of the S&P 500 drop, watching the price of Goldman or Morgan or some of the remaining firms drop. And that led to the conclusion that catastrophe was at hand and anything that could be done should be done, violate all the rules of free markets, violate all the rules that if you make big mistakes, you have to pay the consequence. Forget about the fiscal impact of these enormous kinds of bailouts and intervention. Do what you need to do, and it was all right there on the BlackBerries. Now, my argument is that I blame the bailouts on the occupiers, actually. But the occupiers were in the third floor of the Treasury building, and most of them were from Wall Street and Goldman Sachs. And they fundamentally confused a healthy correction of enormous amount of excess speculation and leverage that was built into Wall Street, built into the financial markets, especially after the dot-com bust and Greenspan then panicked and reflated the bubble with his 1% money and so forth. And all of that needed to be cleaned out, needed to be corrected, and yet what the bailouts did was essentially stop it cold. Now, I mention this because that started us down the path of these massive, what I call Keynesian interventions, the big money printing campaign that I just described, the fiscal tidal wave that has now taken the national debt to $17 trillion. And rather than get into a complete debate right at this moment about all the reasons why I think those bailouts weren't necessary, that AIG was not some kind of contagious disease that was going to spread itself all around the country. It was a gambling operation at the holding company that could have gone into Chapter 11. All of the insurance companies were protected by state regulators, capital standards, dividend stoppers, and so forth, which means they couldn't have gotten the money out of the insurance companies to pay off the gambling debts for the CDS they wrote and for the big banks that were buying it from Morgan's or from Goldman all the way over to Deutsche Bank, SocGen, and the other Europeans. But the point that I'm trying to make is that once this was done, it started this campaign of massive financial intervention on a predicate that in my book I try to lay out in quite substantial detail wasn't valid. But now that it's done and we're 4 years later, I would like to mention a few reasons or benchmarks that I think you can see out there that suggest whether it was needed or not, it hasn't worked. And what I do is look at where we were in those dark hours of late 2008, where we are now, using basically the big numbers that are available for the end of 2012. So that's a 4 year period. And I would like to suggest sort of 8 indicators that I think are really solid benchmarks that suggests this massive intervention hasn't worked except to spur new bubbles, but it hasn't solved our economic problems, and it's only going to get us into the next bubble and crash in an even deeper hole than we were in before. So let's take criteria number one. What has happened in that 4 year period to the net worth of the top 7%? Of the households in America, that's about 8 million people. And remember, it was a dark hour in late 2008. The top 8 million households had lost a little bit. They only had $29 trillion of net worth left after the big liquidation and the meltdown on Wall Street. Now, compared to that $29 trillion of net worth to the top 7%, after this huge stimulus that we've had, monetary and fiscal, where are we today 4 years later? Well, thank you. The top 7% of households now have a net worth of roughly $42 trillion. So it's up $13 trillion, which is a pretty goodly sum over 4 years. It's up 45%. And if you remember, the Republicans had a candidate in the last campaign who kept whining about a class war being conducted out of the White House. Well, I say, if that's the result of a class war, I wonder what a real one would be. So the top 7% is doing pretty well, thank you. The net worth at $42 trillion is way higher than it ever was even before the last bubble broke. Now, the second measure is, what about the other 111 million households that are left, the 93%? And I remember well in my supply-side days when I was in the White House, I really did believe, and a lot of the supply-siders believed, that a rising tide would lift all boats. Well, we have had a tsunami of fiscal and monetary intervention and stimulus and injection into the economy. But has the tide lifted the boats? The answer is not so much. The bottom 93% lost a fair amount in the liquidation of the housing industry and the housing market as a result of the mortgage crash. And even though a tiny bit is recovered, here we are 4 years later comparing the same late 2008, late 2012. The net worth of the bottom 93% is still $24.5 trillion, exactly where it was 4 years ago. So there was no tide from this that lifted any boats. As a matter of fact, if you put it in real terms, the net worth of most of our country is now down 5% from the low point after the crisis. And it's actually down in real terms, adjusted for inflation, 25% from where it was way back in March 2000, the first time that the stock market approached approximately this level. So what I'm suggesting is this isn't working unless you're in the small part of the household sector that is invested in what I call the casino that Wall Street has been turned into as a result of these Fed policies. Number three, how about the Main Street economy? Back when the bubble, when the dot-com bubble first hit, there were 72 million middle-income, or what I call breadwinner jobs in the United States. Now, the reason I call them that is they pay on average $50,000. You can almost support a family with that. They are full-time in construction, manufacturing, the white-collar professions, state and local, federal government, full-time civil service, and so forth. And by the time we got to the bottom in late 2008, there were only 70 million of those jobs. Now, 4 years later, after this massive stimulus that came out of the idea that it worked during the New Deal, today there's 67.5 million full-time breadwinner jobs in the United States. In other words, we have lost ground since the bottom in late 2008. All the jobs that have been created since then, or most all of them, are part-time jobs that actually are simply born-again jobs that were created once in the mid-80 bubble and then lost, and now they've come back. Another measure of how well this works, and I've laid this out in my book, is the median household income, which has to be a pretty good measure in real terms adjusted for inflation, of how the Main Street economy is working. Today, then, at the at the bottom in late 2008, was 54,000. Today, it's 50,000. So here we are, 4 years later, the median income has actually shrunk by about 8%. How well, another measure is, what about the people who were left behind? I think a good measure of that is the population on food stamps and disability. At the bottom, in late 2008, there were roughly 30 million people on food stamps and disability. Today, after 4 years of this massive deluge, there are 60 million people on food stamps and disability. In other words, one out of every five citizens. Again, a suggestion that all of this is not fixing the underlying problem of our Main Street economy. You can look at many other things, real business investment, labor hours in the economy, and so forth. Overall, we spent about $3 trillion fiscally in the stimulus and then the follow-on, in the 2010 and 2011. And the point that I make in my book about this is that only $100 billion of that $3 trillion multiple stimulus programs ended up going into programs that are means-tested safety net programs for the people who really have no other alternative. And I'm talking about food stamps, I'm talking about earned income tax credit, I'm talking about SSI and other forms of public assistance. only 3% went into that category. Most of the rest of it was just tax cuts or rebates to middle-income people, so they would go out and buy some more flat-screen TVs or some shoes or, you know, another meal at the Red Lobster or something. But that doesn't make sense because we were simply borrowing it from the future, laying it on future generations, passing it out randomly to people who may or may not have needed it, and it's not done a lot to really rebuild the fundamental condition of our economy. So the reason I'm mentioning all that is here we are 80 years on from the New Deal. We've had a massive test of the Keynesian policies, both monetary and fiscal, a kind of shock and awe campaign, as I called it, and I think the results are pretty damning. We have basically today another speculative mania going on everywhere. You saw it in the market today, but actually you can see it all over the country. We have junk bonds that are now yielding under 5%. Now, in an honest market where the Fed wasn't manipulating everything and flooding the market with money and holding interest rates practically to zero, the Treasury bond would yield 5%, because that would be roughly inflation plus the historic 2 to 3% spread. But when you have junk bonds yielding 5%, they're going to borrow hand over fist. They're going to use them to recapitalize companies. They're going to then, obviously, and I was in the LBO business, so I know what they do, strip mine the cash out of those companies, use it to pay the interest, and even now we've got what's called the levered recap going on once again. And that's the worst, because you take companies that are already levered to LBOs at 5 or 6 times cash flow, you put some more debt on it, and the debt doesn't go to the company for capital spending or for reinvestment in the business. It's paid out immediately as a dividend to the small slice of equity owners at the top. Now, we have another example of bubble, you know, the kind of Greenspan Bernanke bubble showing itself in what the subprime is back. Only this time, it's subprime auto. And by that, I mean they're now out 40% of the market for new cars, which everybody says isn't this great, it's coming back. 40% is funded by subprime loans that are going to people with credit scores that really don't have them, 500 or less, that don't even necessarily have a full-time or permanent job. And as a matter of fact, they're taking shotguns and PlayStations as collateral for a down payment just in case you don't have any cash. So this is going on in the another part of the bubbly financial system that's being regenerated. Today, you have $5,000 suits riding on the back of John Deere lawnmowers heading into Scottsdale, Arizona to buy up distressed properties by the hundreds and thousands. But if you think Wall Street funds, hedge funds, and LBO funds are natural owners of single-family homes spread all over suburban America, where they're going to have great expertise in managing crabgrass in the lawn and insects in the tree, then I don't think you've been paying attention. It is not a natural investment scheme. It's the result of 2% money, which is being shoveled out by the Fed as part of this whole stimulus thing we have going. Now, meanwhile, what's happening to the retired Americans and the savers in America? They're getting crushed, and I give my favorite example is compare Granny to Goldman Sachs, and I'm not picking on Goldman Sachs just because they're an easy target, but well, maybe that's why I am, because everybody understands it. But the point is, if you had actually saved over a lifetime $100,000 by being thrifty, by being prudent, by maybe not buying a new car every year and so forth, and you were retired with your husband today, you're going to make $400 of interest on a CD if you keep that $100,000 liquid and safe because you might need it because you're in your late 70s or early 80s. Now, that is a direct result of the Fed in its wisdom deciding that people ought to be in junk bond funds or the Russell 2000 or in the stock market and not in something that's safe and liquid and available when you need it. It's totally manipulated, it's totally artificial, and I say it's totally wrong, but it's a consequence of the idea that you can't stimulate the economy enough. Now, on the other hand, if you're Goldman Sachs today, you could go out into the market, buy $1 billion worth of treasury bonds that are yielding 1.9%, immediately put them up as collateral on repo, borrow 98 cents on the dollar, pay 10 basis points for your borrowing, collect the spread, 180 basis points, it's $50,000 a day of found money, and you can sleep at night like a baby because Bernanke has said he's going to keep the price of the bonds up and he's going to keep the borrowing cost for overnight at zero. So when you compare what's happening to millions of savers as a result of this misguided policy with the almost legalized thievery that is occurring in the distorted, deformed financial markets as a result of this, you can see why I think this whole scheme is not succeeding. Now, they tell you every month there's new jobs created, but I'll tell you what they are. They're born-again part-time jobs. In 2000, the last time the stock market was up here, there were 34.7 million part-time jobs, like in retail, restaurants, bars, temp agencies, and so forth. Then in the first Greenspan reflation, the 7 years up to 2007 when we got to the top, that number went up to 37.2, so we had about 2.5 million jobs created. Then the bust came, all of them disappeared. And so by the time we got to the bottom, we were back down to 34.7, all 2.5 million disappeared. And now here we are in April 2013, and the same 2.5 million jobs have been born again, and we have 37.2 million jobs in the part-time sector of the economy. They pay the amazing sum of $19,000 a year. Nobody can live on that. Nobody can support a family on that. Those are the only jobs that we're creating, or the type of jobs that we're creating, and they're born-again jobs because we already had them once back in the mid-2000s, 5s, 6s, and 7s. So I call it the economic equivalent of a Billy Graham crusade. These jobs just keep getting saved over and over. They're the same jobs. Now, this has led to a huge fiscal problem, and I don't want to spend too much time going into all the intricacies of that, but I think we're nearing a position where we're broke, where we can't deal with the real problems, which is supporting the safety net, which I think a government has to do with the economy in the shape that it's in and in this day and age. But the fact is we are now in a circumstance fiscally where the system is frozen and paralyzed. And I use as my number one example the defense budget that we're looking at today, which is $650 billion. It is a vast war machine that adds up to the 7 or 8 next defense budgets in the world. Now, I want to just mention that because it really proves that as we got deeper and deeper into this Keynesian idea, everything became a job program. It was no longer, do you need more M1 tanks? Of course not. Do you need more aircraft carriers? Of course not. But they keep funding them because all of it has become a jobs program. That's the way they look at it politically. That's the way the political action committees work. That's the way the fundraising process works. And if you look at our defense budget overall, it is truly startling. $650 billion, 1.5 million men and women under arms, 800,000 civilians supporting them, another million in the reserves and National Guard, in a world where we have no industrial enemies left. And they keep having little debates in Washington about whether or not, they ought to sequester 10 or 20 or 30 billion dollars. But the bigger picture is, the Cold War ended 25 years ago. The Soviet Union is no more. We have a $650 billion budget compared to $400 billion that Clinton left. And, I didn't see any, invasion forces coming at us then. or $400 billion in today's dollars that Eisenhower left in 1960 when he warned about the military-industrial complex. So why do we have this massive war machine, this massive budget, when, as I say, what we face today is Russia? And Russia obviously has become a kleptocracy. And they're far more interested in stealing from each other, obviously, than they are harming their neighbor. Who is the other industrial threat that requires this huge war machine? Well, apparently it is Red China, if you remember that old phrase. But Red China is the greatest export machine in the world. They couldn't last 6 weeks without their enormous flow of exports to the United States or Western Europe. And so the question becomes, are they really going to bomb 3,000 Walmarts throughout America sometime down the road? Or why do we have 11 carrier battle groups when they have one? China has one carrier battle group. We have 11. They cost $30 or $40 billion each, plus billions to operate. And the question you might ask is, well, where did they come about? How did they come upon their carrier, aircraft carrier? The answer is they bought it used from the Ukraine. And I'm sure that some of you are not a little puzzled because you didn't know that the Ukraine was a major naval power. But it's actually not. The Ukraine stole it from the Soviet Union when it collapsed a long time ago. Now, I'm mentioning this, and I have two others to mention quickly, as a measure of how frozen, paralyzed, and lacking in sanity the fiscal policy is today. And it's not about defense, it's about jobs, it's about propping up the economy. It's about the Keynesian predicate that if the government isn't constantly injecting new funds, new stimulus into the economy or existing spending, that everything's going to fall apart. And as a result of that, we have Republicans who are unwilling to face up to the fact that we need a lot of new revenue because we're never going to get government below 20% of GDP. The current tax system brings in about 17%. The Republican Party is supposed to be the party of fiscal rectitude, the party that looks after the long-run financial welfare of the country, and yet it is basically reverted to, as I say in my book, becoming, they've adopted a kind of Keynesian policy for the prosperous classes. So there isn't any tax cut that you can imagine that they haven't embraced, and they haven't been willing to stand up to the revenue that's needed. Now, if you look at the Democrats, frankly, I'm an equal opportunity critic, and I think their position on Social Security is just as bullheaded and just as wrong, and frankly, I reach all the way back to the New Deal and blame the New Deal for the mistake of social insurance. People who can pass a means test and who don't have assets and don't have a pension and don't have other sources of income ought to get support from the state if they're retired or if they're poor or if they can't get a job or they're disabled and so forth. But it needs to be means tested. And what we're learning today is that when you don't means test a program and you get 55 million people on it and they all join AARP, it becomes impossible to make any rational choices about the $1.5 trillion that we spend every year for Social Security and Medicare on a non-means tested basis. The other thing I point out in my book, on the other hand, is that because they bought the ideology of social insurance, which came right out of 1935, New Deal era, because they bought the ideology of social insurance and trust funds, they basically took hostage the working class of America with a payroll tax that then seemed pretty innocuous, 2% of wages, which today is a jobs destroyer because it's 16% of wages, Most of the jobs that we're creating today, and you heard some of the numbers that I mentioned, are at the entry level because we've lost our manufacturing and our tradable goods industries and so forth. And yet when we generate just a limited number of entry-level or low-wage jobs, we hit it immediately with a 15% payroll tax because that's what's needed to fund Social Security in order to perpetuate the myth of the trust fund. But that's a myth. There's nothing in the trust fund. It's confetti. You can't turn all those intergovernment bonds into payments to beneficiaries down the road. Those wages came in 20, 30 years ago. They were spent on cotton subsidies and aircraft carriers and government salaries. There's nothing in there. And so we have basically, it's turned social insurance, allegedly the great creation of the New Deal, has turned into a transfer payment program between the low-wage workers on the one hand and the affluent retirees on the other hand. So we throw the low-wage worker under the bus, take 15% employer-employee out of his hide. We then run it through this so-called trust fund that doesn't really exist and send it down to Florida so some duffer can spend the day playing 18 holes of golf collect his $30,000 when he doesn't need it. Now, the reason I mention that is that the system is paralyzed over social insurance. The liberals and the progressives keep defending the whole system. They keep the workers of America hostage to this huge payroll tax. We're not competitive. That's why we don't have jobs. And the last thing you ought to be doing is taxing wages that hard. Yet, that's the fiscal system. That's the kind of doomsday machine that was inadvertently created. I don't think anybody in 1935 had the slightest idea that you would reach a point someday where the numbers and the demographics would turn so negative. I don't think they had any idea that once you unleashed the entire population to demand more and more benefits, you would get a Richard Nixon, who was allegedly a conservative, putting a 20% payroll or a Social Security increase into effect the month before the 1972 election just to make sure that nothing went wrong. And so what we have then is a lot of legacies from the New Deal, Social Security being one of them, but the Keynesian idea being another, both in fiscal and monetary policy, that today are coming a cropper. There is obviously a lot of answer to all of these things, but I guess what I want to say now is that that completes chapter one of my book, I'm sure that there's going to be a question or two that people want to ask, and rather than carry on with more of this, I'll stop at this point and be happy to take your questions. Thank you.
If I remember correctly, in 1982, when you were head, of OMB, you announced in rather odd circumstances a change of policy, whereby the Republican Party would no longer be the guardian of the budget and against spending, but rather would go the opposite direction, incur spending and incur debt, and in the process defeat the Democrats by overburdening the budget with debt and then cutting off social programs. Now, it seems to have worked. And I just wondered, did I remember correctly that you were the author of that program?
No, you didn't remember correctly. That's why I didn't last, okay? I eventually got run out of town on a rail, tarred and feathered and otherwise. But the program started with a good idea that because of the roaring inflation of the 70s, tax brackets were creeping up and we needed to reset income taxes. But we always believed, I did, that it had to be matched with major shrinkage of the domestic budget and that anything we did on defense ought to be limited. And what happened was within months, the defense budget just got totally out of control. I've got a whole chapter on how essentially we created a war machine that had nothing to do with the Soviet Union and eventually became the army of invasion and occupation in the 90s and the 2000s. But that got out of control, became, you know, the defense budget grew by double what was originally projected. Then trying to pass the tax cut, since no one believed really in supply side, they believed in K Street, they believed in lobbies, they believed in loopholes, we ended up in a bidding war to pass the so-called supply side tax cut, the Reagan tax cut, and it ended up double the size that was originally intended. I lay this out in the book, 6% of GDP rather than 3 to 4, because the Democrats got into the same race and they had all of their goodies and loopholes and so forth on the table. And then it turned out that the Republicans really didn't feel like they wanted to cut spending as much as all their speeches had indicated over the previous 3 or 4 or 5 decades. So we ended up cutting the domestic budget by only a few percentage points, and a lot of that didn't last. And as a matter of fact, when Ronald Reagan left office, the welfare state budget, so-called, the domestic budget, was 14.4% of GDP, which was slightly under the 14.6% of GDP where Jimmy Carter left it in 1980. So my point is, not much was changed. Not any programs were eliminated of any significant nature. The big social insurance programs that I've talked about were hardly touched at all, Social Security and Medicare. In fact, when we tried to reform Social Security, the thing was denounced and died within 10 days in May of 1981. So if you put those three elements together, the revenue base being totally depleted and ended up at like 15% of GDP, lower than it was when Truman was in the White House, spending being hardly nicked at all, and the defense budget soaring out of control, what you got was $200 billion deficits as far as the eye could see. And it scared the hell out of me. It scared the hell out of most people in Washington at the time. But unfortunately, there were the supply-siders who had the president's ear, and they said, well, Jimmy Carter caused it, or if you wait long enough, you're going to grow out of it. Neither of those turned out to be true. We did talk him into raising small amounts of taxes a couple of times, but the bottom line is that started us on the road to deficits don't matter. And it unbalanced our democracy, because I say in a two-party healthy democracy, you've got to have competition on the fiscal issue, and the Democrats should be the party that wants to, pass out the goodies, and the Republican Party has to do hard labor on the oars of fiscal rectitude and occasionally say no, occasionally demand tough choices, and constantly warn the people that you can't just borrow your way indefinitely to prosperity. But once that was lost and the Republican Party became a free lunch party on taxes and in competition with the Democrats on spending, we ended up where we are today. And they're telling you the budget's getting a little better. That's really minor, temporary, as a result of a lot of tax collections that came at the end of the year when everybody tried to beat the increase in the capital gains tax, but it's not a persistent, enduring fix. We're still looking at $1 trillion kind of deficits year in and year out. Now, I think that the Reagan era is another part of my book that's part of represents the mythology that is driving policy today. Republicans think it was some golden era of prosperity and a booming economy and everything worked out perfectly. I say no. If you look at the numbers, GDP grew at 3% from 84 to 91. That was about average. Meanwhile, the deficit tripled. and we were in big trouble, except Greenspan got in the Fed and started printing money like there was no tomorrow in the 1990s. And then the Asians, the Chinese and the Japanese and the Koreans and the rest of them got into the act. And they start running their printing presses and their central banks. And to keep their currency exchange rates down, they bought dollars and loaded up the vaults of their central banks with treasury bonds and bills. And that's how we financed our way through the 1990s and the last 10 years or so of the kind of structural deficits that were created way back then. So my argument in the book is that Reagan didn't prove that deficits don't matter, as Dick Cheney said. It was one of the most unfortunate, erroneous, reckless, I can't think of enough bad words for it, dangerous statements ever made. He only proved that if the central bank wants to buy bonds and bills and all of them get together and do it long enough, you can defer the day of reckoning. But now we have all the central banks in the world in a huge race to the bottom. They're all doing the same thing, the Bank of England, the ECB. What they're doing in Japan today is just lunatic. They're going to double the size of the balance sheet of their central bank in 2 years. And they're essentially trying to do over and over what I've described here today as a policy that doesn't work. I remember Einstein was quoted once as saying that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over and expecting a different result. Well, that's what's going on in China today. That's what we're doing here. We're in our fourth bubble since the year 2000. It's not going to work. It hasn't worked. And yet the idea that the central bank and the people running the taxing and spending system of the government can somehow make the economy perform better and keep it growing and propped up and healthy and expanding, I think has been proved so wrong that it's amazing to me that we just keep doing the same old thing.
My name is Suzanne Serbeck. I'm a writer in New York, and I wanted to know if you think the debt ceiling should be raised again at the end of the summer, and if you don't think so, what steps could be taken to prevent what many people would be a catastrophe for the U.S.?
Well, first of all, I think the catastrophe has already happened. In other words, the built-in borrowing is so fantastic over the next 5 or 10 years that we're going to have a debt ceiling crisis every 3 months or every year from now until as far as the eye can see. And I take exception to the idea that the debt ceiling should just ratify what we've already done. I think in an orderly democracy, we wouldn't be in the massive hole that we're in today, and that argument would be persuasive. But I think we today have both parties just kicking the can, burying their head in the sand, and unless we have debt ceiling crises, they're never going to make tough decisions. Now, look what happened in January. After 10 years of the Democrats denouncing the Bush tax cuts as unaffordable, wrong, et cetera, and I agree with all that, they never should have been put in, and blaming anything that was going wrong in our society on the Bush tax cuts, then we get to the point where they were going to expire for the 98%. Fine, you know, they let the 2% pay their fair share. That's fine with me. But they could not even face up to the prospect of telling the middle class in America, you're going to have to pay more revenue to support this government that you keep demanding be funded at these high levels. They should have let it expire. It would have reduced the deficit by $4 trillion over the next 10 years. Remember, these are income tax rates, so therefore, the bottom half of the households wouldn't have even been impacted because they don't pay income tax. They do pay payroll. They do pay sales tax and all the rest of it. So if there was any time where you could get some revenue back into the till to pay our bills, here was the ideal time, because they didn't have to do anything. The law was expiring. They could sit on their hands and let it happen and blame the other side. But even that they couldn't do. even that, a progressive president, so-called, has to stand up and say, I'm going to give the middle class in America a tax reduction that we, and these are my words, not his, that we obviously can't afford, and we're going to keep all this spending going, we're going to keep this war machine going, we're going to keep Social Security totally intact, and we're not going to tax anybody except the 2%. Now, that's really where it's come out. So when I get hawkish on debt ceilings and not just raising them automatically, not just ratifying them because it's, quote, the responsible thing to do, I say, look at the alternative. This is a doomsday machine. They just keep ducking every issue. They couldn't even let the Bush tax cuts, which had a bad name, expire and ask the American middle class, upper middle class, to pay for the government that everybody wants. I think it's a measure of the dysfunction. I think it's a measure of the ideological paralysis that we have in our system today. And so when the debt ceiling comes up, there's going to be another crisis, and it'll be one of many, unfortunately, that we're going to have year after year. The good question, how do I explain the Clinton surpluses? Well, if you look at my book, I've got 18 villains, policy villains, and 18 heroes, and Clinton is one of the heroes, along with Paul Volcker and along with people going back a long time in history, Eisenhower mainly, because he balanced the budget four times. He took on the Pentagon and cut it down to size. He said, and I'm mentioning Eisenhower now because I meant to before, he said, I would like to cut taxes, but you got to earn it first. If you balance the budget, then you have the right to do the easy stuff, tell the American people you're going to give them a tax cut. But I do give Clinton credit for not doing what the liberal wing wanted him to do, which is to use the revenue that was coming in from the great tech boom, the great Greenspan stock market boom of the late 90s for programs. He used it to balance the budget, and that was kind of a miracle, but it wasn't sustainable, frankly, because then you got the Republican Cheney tax cutters in 2000. And more importantly, the revenue was bloated quite measurably as a result of all the capital gains and the kind of bonuses, massive bonuses that were being earned on Wall Street and in Silicon Valley for a few years at the end of the 90s. But at least we proved that we could do it then. At least you had some presidential leadership that was willing to take on his own base, which he did at the time. But I say here we are 13 years later, and I can't see anyone in either party willing to take on their base. And as a result of that, Social Security gets a free ride. Military-industrial complex keeps their jobs program going, and taxes remain far too low. And that's the paralysis we're in. And the unfortunate part of this is, sooner or later, all this debt's going to be a tax on somebody 10 years from now, 20 years, 40 years from now. But in the meantime, what's going to get hit the hardest is the safety net. The one thing that government does that it could do and that isn't all that expensive relative to the GDP, but that's the first thing that the Republicans now try to cut, and I dispute that enormously. You look at the whole Ryan budget, Social Security, complete pass for 10 years. Medicare, he reforms it in the by and by, 10 years, no savings. So out of $19 billion for social insurance over the next 10 years, he doesn't cut a dime. And then you take the social safety net, $7 trillion over the next 10 years, that goes to means-tested programs like Medicaid and food stamps and SSI and so forth, earned income tax credit, he cuts it by 30%. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this is where we're headed. As this fiscal paralysis continues to intensify and dig itself in, you're going to have a tax on the weak claims, not the weak clients. And that was something that I articulated way back in 1981. Cut the weak claims like the Export-Import Bank or the wealthy people on Social Security or unnecessary defense spending. Don't cut the weak clients who actually have a claim on the support of their fellow citizens. We're heading in the opposite direction, And that's another reason why this fiscal problem is far more serious than a lot of people think. Maybe way back here, yes.
You're talking about raising taxes. I wondered what you think about the tax on stock trading.
That it retards the creation of jobs. Secondly, I believe the government has a responsibility to supplement the income of people who are doing the best they can, and maybe they can only hold a minimum wage job, or maybe they're only making $20,000 a year and cannot support a family on that income. Then I think the right thing to do is transfer payments through the earned income tax credit or a negative income tax or something to add to what they're learning to get to some, or earning to get to some minimum standard of living. That's what the government ought to be doing. But it shouldn't be starting solar companies. It shouldn't be putting $500 million into something called Tesla, which is making $100,000 cars for rich guys with federal money, which makes no sense whatsoever. It shouldn't be still subsidizing farm commodities when we're in the biggest commodity boom in recorded history. So what I'm suggesting is that we need to be far more discriminating, and we have to start prioritizing. Now, the one thing that I'll say regarding where we are today versus the 1930s, I don't believe that most of what Roosevelt did got us out of the Depression. That's another whole debate. But I will say that when he started the larger deficits, the debt of the United States was only 16% of GDP. So at least there was headroom, so to speak. The balance sheet had runway on it. So if you believed that you ought to have the Public Works Administration or the WPA or the Tennessee Valley Authority, at least there was room on the balance sheet. Today, it's 100%. We've used up the balance sheet, and so therefore we can't spend money, in my view, on stuff that is not the highest priority, and the highest priority is the safety net. The tax problem, we have to raise more taxes. The theory of supply side is if you want more of something, tax it less. If you want less of something, tax it more. I think we have massive gambling on Wall Street as a result of the cheap money that goes into what I described as the Goldman trade. And so therefore, I would think that's one of the easier ways to generate some revenue, a so-called Tobin tax, a transaction tax. I don't think it would be the end of the world. But if you listen to, it's not going to happen. Because, they own lock, stock, and barrel, the Finance and Ways and Means Committee, and I don't mean just Goldman, but I mean all of Wall Street. And as a result of that, I think that is a plausible idea that has, a very small chance of ever being enacted.
With a $17 trillion public debt, don't you think that a survey and perhaps a leverage of public assets is a matter of due diligence and basic accounting? And my question, the public assets that I have in mind are the 700 million acres of subsurface mineral estate that the country possesses under the Bureau of Land Management, and also the gold reserves, but untethered to a gold standard, that these can be securitized or locally monetized to actually decimate the debt, taking chunks out of it that now people are arguing about 2-3% per decade, perhaps taking 25% out of the debt right away.
I've never seen the facts that persuade me that that's feasible or doable. I realize there is the biggest landowner in the world is the United States government, and I guess there are subsurface mineral rights, and we are selling those off as we go along. But I don't buy the idea at all that it somehow is a magic elixir that's going to allow us to pay down our debt. I don't think that's the case. The only way we're ever going to get this $17 trillion national debt under control that you mentioned is if we start being honest with the people and telling them that if you want 24 or 22 or 20% of GDP in spending for all these good things, then you're going to have to pay the taxes and pay your bills. Otherwise, we're just going to have a massive catastrophe 10 or 20 or 30 years down the road. So you have to do it through taxes. There are no gimmicks. You have to do it through the most efficient, the fairest, the most balanced system of taxes that you can come up with. And today, we're on the edge of insolvency, I believe. And so therefore, even if the taxes slow down the economy, even if they interfere with growth or investment or the job creators a little bit, or maybe even a lot, you have to pay your bills. We've been, you know, living on kind of a borrowed prosperity for decades now. And unfortunately, the bill is coming due. The day of reckoning is here. I think we have time for one more question. So over here. Yeah.
Hi. I gather then you would want regulation of the
banks?
Of the banks.
Oh,
and
yes.
One other thing, too. would you want the Hoover Commission applied to the government?
The which one?
Hoover Commission. That was a different way of handling the budgets there,
yeah.
So that they could hold money for a period of time rather than doing what they do in corporations and everywhere, that if you have some money left in one area, you know that you're not going to get the money again, and they'll make sure to spend it, whereas the otherwise, they would save it for a period of time and use it for
the Hoover
else.
Commission was named after President Hoover. I'm loath to say anything good about President Hoover in this particular setting, but I don't think he was as bad as he was made out to be. But I do think it was a different circumstance. Yeah, I know. And my point, though, is that we have not even addressed the banking problem. The fundamental truth is if they're too big to fail, they're too big to exist. And what we've done is just kick the can. It's 4 years later. The legislation that was passed, Frank Dodd, is, you know, Dodd-Frank, I call it an exercise in regulatory pettifoggery. No one will ever know what it means. It will not be effective. It's being diluted and litigated and watered down and delayed. And basically, all the banks are back to doing the same thing. When we came as close as we did, and I don't think we were on the edge, but that's what the common opinion is, then it seems to me that we should have put the banking system under economic house arrest. And what I mean by that is not criminal prosecution, but saying until we're way out of the woods and absolutely certain that there's not going to be another meltdown like the one we had, you can't pay dividends and you can't go out in the market and massively buy in your stock with the earnings that are basically coming out of the hides of the savers in America. You know, they say they paid back TARP. They didn't pay back TARP. Tens of millions of people in America paid back TARP by getting 40 basis points on their savings. That's how the banks got well. They took the book profits that came out of the massive repression of interest rates on depositors, used it to rebuild their balance sheets. And now here we are with JP Morgan and Citi and Bank of America and all the rest of them demanding the right to be back out in the market again, be free to buy in billions of stock, to boost their dividend, all as a way of juicing the stock and causing executive options to have value. I can't believe we're allowing this to happen. You could have easily said to those banks, Bank of America, JP Morgan, all right, you're booking all this profit. Keep it on the balance sheet as retained earnings as a cushion. Shield for the next time we have any kind of financial crisis. That's what we should have done. It's fairly simple. But the Congress wouldn't even hear of it, and you have a progressive White House who gave them a pass, and the Fed is saying, go ahead and use your earnings that have come out of the hides of the savers of America in order to play games in the stock market. So we have a huge problem, and we haven't even addressed it, unfortunately. Thank you all very much.